In this segment, we will prove this particular theorem which relates the relative change in the solution vector to the relative change which we are making in the coefficient matrix, so far as the norms are concerned. So if we are given a set of equations Ax equal to c, what we want to see is that, hey, if we make a small change in our coefficient matrix given by delta A, then it's going to result in a change in the solution vector which we are denoting by delta x, and we want to show that, hey, the relative change in the solution vector is related to the relative change in the coefficient matrix based on the norms by this quantity right here, which is the norm of A times norm of A inverse, that it can get amplified by as much as this number, which is the norm of A times norm of A inverse, which is also called the condition number of the matrix. This is called the condition number of a matrix, of a square matrix. So let's go and see that how we can prove this. So let A times X be equal to C. So this is a given set of equations which we have. Now what we are doing is that we are making a change to the coefficient matrix. We're making A to be A prime. Then we know that, hey, if we keep the right-hand side to be the same, it is going to result in a change in the solution vector, and let's call it X prime. Now, if that's the case, then let's go and define now two different matrices. One matrix we'll define as, hey, what is delta A? Delta A we're defining as A prime minus A. So it is the coefficient matrix which we changed it to minus what was the original A matrix, and delta X will be called to be X prime minus X. So it has a difference between what this X got changed to minus the original solution vector. So based on this, let's go and see that how we can figure out what is the relationship between the relative change in the X to the relative change in the A matrix right here. So we know that A times X is equal to C, and so is A prime times X prime equal to C. So that means that this quantity is same as this quantity right here. So I can write that A times X is equal to A prime times X prime, because the right-hand side is the same. But we know that A prime is nothing but A plus delta A. What the original A matrix was, what the change to it is. And we know X prime is nothing but X plus delta X. So based on this, we can use our rules of binary operations here. So we can say, hey, this is A times X plus delta A. Delta A times X plus A times delta X plus delta A times delta X. So we're basically expanding this multiplication of these two matrices to be that, and that's A times X. Now what we're going to do is, since this is same as this, that cancels out. And what we're going to do is we're going to bring this part here to the left-hand side. So that becomes minus A times delta X. And that will be equal to delta A times X plus delta A times delta X. Which is same as saying that, hey, let's put this as delta A times X plus delta X. So we're just taking delta A common out of these two additions, and we get that. Now since we have this, what we can also do is we can multiply both sides by A inverse. So I can say A inverse A times delta X. So we're assuming that inverse does exist, because only then we have a unique solution. So assuming that A inverse does exist for this set of equations, we're going to multiply by A inverse on both sides. So I get A inverse times delta A times X plus delta X right here, like this. So the reason why we're doing that is because we're trying to get what delta x is, and then we're going to apply some theorems about norms, the properties of norms, to be able to come up with this proof of our theorem. So this and this does not cancel, but I shouldn't have put that, but it gives us the int matrix. So I should say int times delta x. So this A inverse times A will be the int matrix, because we're assuming that A inverse exists. So A inverse times delta A times x plus delta x. So we get right there. And since I times any int matrix multiplied by any other matrix is the matrix itself, provided of course the multiplication is defined, which is in this case. So we get minus delta x times A inverse times delta A times x plus delta x. Now we already know that if we find the norm of this matrix right here, that has to be less than the product of these three norms. So what I mean by saying is that if we apply the theorem that, hey, the norm of this matrix here will be less than or equal to the product of this norm, norm of this, and norm of this. So what we get is the norm of delta x will be less than or equal to norm of A inverse times norm of delta A times norm x plus delta x. So we are shedding these brackets here just for simplicity purposes. They're still there, but so that it doesn't look bad, that's why we're shedding these brackets there. But these are still matrices, but then the norm of those matrices is simply a single scalar, a positive scalar. Now what we're going to do is we're going to multiply by A, norm of A. Again, norm of A is not going to be 0, because if it is 0, then you will not have an inverse of the matrix. It will be less than equal to norm of A times norm of A inverse times norm of delta A times norm of x plus delta x. Keep in mind that what we are doing is we are multiplying by a scalar here, which is norm of A, and as I said, that norm of A is even if it was 0, it will still hold the inequality. But we know that norm of A is not 0, because if it were, then A inverse will not exist. So now what we do is we do a little bit of manipulation here. We did norm delta x. We take this x plus delta x norm to the left-hand side. And keep in mind that these inequalities will not change, because all we are doing is that we are using positive numbers throughout the inequality. So that doesn't change our inequality from less than equal to or to greater than equal to. And from here, I'll get norm of A times norm of A inverse times norm of delta A divided by norm of A. And the reason why we multiplied both sides by A was so that we get the condition number right here. That was the only reason why we did that. And so now we have the relative change in the solution vector can be amplified by as much as the condition number of the coefficient matrix if you are making a change in the coefficient matrix. And that's the proof of this theorem, and that of course is the end of this segment.